What's up? What's up, y'all? Back at it once again. It's a Koski of Fun Day kicking it for you and for yours. And before I get too deep into this, I give a shout out to my ancestors. You know, give me, you know, this knowledge, strength, and wisdom and understanding to go through this, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, just dropping the knowledge and the jewels for me. And also, I thank y'all, the viewer, the watcher, you know, for doing what y'all do and making me, you know, possible blow like I've been blowing. You know, y'all stay safe out there with that COVID. You know, that stuff real is knocking cats off. You know, so anywho, with that being said, while that stuff is going on, we still gonna kick African history. You know what I'm saying? And put it down, inscribe it down for the future generations and the babies that come forth with and after with after this. So that's our goal and that's our mission. Now this right here is the Lusaka Manifesto Strategy of the A or the OAU states and its consequences for the freedom struggle in Southern Africa. Now many people don't know about the Lusaka Manifesto, you know what I'm saying? So we gotta talk about it, you know, because there's a lot of things that not being discussed. The Lusaka Manifesto is an old document now, 8 years old, today, April 1977. Compared to the other more recent OAU declarations on the subject of Southern Africa. But there are three compelling reasons why we should discuss the strategy adopted 8 years in the Zimbabwean capital, Lusaka. This article will re-examine the Lusaka Manifesto strategy in some detail because, one, we should assess and evaluate the strategy in light of the experience of the last 8 years. We should discuss and evaluate the consequences of the strategy of the current struggle for freedom and independence in Southern Africa. Sidebar right quick, the term consequences, all right? That don't mean it's negative, don't mean positive. You know what I'm saying? There's positive consequences and negative consequences. So, you know, just to kill, you know, to kill off the little negative connotation of the word consequences. Back to it. Particular attention will be paid to the Pina Agreement between Portugal and its competing Angolan liberation movements in 1974. The Lusaka Accord between Zimbabwe leaders in Lusaka in 1974 and the Turner Hall Conference inside Namibia and related issues. Two publications in recent years have thrown much of the light on the Lusaka Manifesto. There is a published correspondence between President Kenneth Kaunda of Zambia and Mr. John Forster, Prime Minister of South Africa in 1968, which now appears to have been a buildup towards the manifesto. Either individually or on behalf of the groups of states, Kaunda was fishing in troubled waters to see where the fish and crocodiles lie. On the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, in the same year, Dr. Henry Kissinger presented several options on Southern Africa to President Richard M. Nixon in the now famous Tar Baby Memorandum or Memorandum Number 39 of October 1969. Sidebar, we're going to talk about that too in this one, the Tar Baby Memorandum, you know what I'm saying? Memorandum 39. And we're going to have another video on it going more extensively into it. There are points of convergence and divergence between the manifesto and the memorandum, which will be discussed below. Number three, although the OAU has issued several other documents on Southern Africa, most notably Mogadishu 1970 and Dar es Salaam in 1974 declarations, the overall strategy has remained at the old Lusaka document. This document was endorsed by both the OAU and the General Assembly of the United Nations and has remained a rallying point of the OAU powers against those few states that advocate dialogue with South Africa on the one hand or those that seek outright commitment to armed struggle on the other. Of the positive features of the manifesto, the one that should be mentioned at the outset was that it drew attention of the world at an early stage to the critical issues of race and color in an arena of growing strategic importance. In the recent years, the two major powers, the USA and the USSR, has vastly increased their interest in the area. The civil war in Angola led a fuse in Southern Africa and nearly brought the major power to blows. Stern warnings were issued both from Washington and Moscow, followed by visits of senior government officials to the area and increased militarization of the Indian Ocean and select governments on the mainland. The danger of escalating the current guerrilla warfare into a major conflict in which the major powers were involved looms at large in South Africa, in Southern Africa. The situation had all the makings of a Vietnam-type conflict, including ample supplies of dampening fluids and theses. The liberation movement has scored major victories against the colonial forces. In every state in Southern Africa, there is a growing national consciousness among the indigenous people and widening in a conflict with the white settler regime and all the colonialist supporters. The greatest victory of all was the collapse of the Portuguese colonial empire at the successful coup d'etat in Portugal of April 24, 1974. The establishment of the colonial government in the former Portuguese colony fired the imagination of Africans in Zimbabwe, Namibia, and South Africa itself. The guerrilla war in Zimbabwe and Namibia gathered momentum. In mid-1976, the urban population of South Africa exploded in school and race riots that caught the regime unaware. The persistent scale of these urban disturbances, especially in Soweto and Johannesburg and Guelalato near Cape Town, was unprecedented in the history of South African freedom struggle. By the end of 1976, the possibility of a major civil war within South Africa was so imminent that the government enacted legislation to give power to deploy heavily armed troops in the Air Force and African residential areas in the event of widespread disturbances. The general idea of liberating the African continent from the colonial rule has kept the OAU united. No matter how bitterly the heads of state disagree on the best method and strategy to be employed, the liberation of Southern Africa invokes applause and deep emotions of solidarity among the head states of the OAU Summit Conference, or the bilateral talks between visiting dignitaries. Some OAU meetings in which deep divisions occurred among members over matters of borders or security, however, found common ground when they moved to reports of the organs' concerns with liberation. Although the Charter of the OAU is generally committed member states to fighting against colonialism, it was the manifesto that had provided an ideological underpinning and the flexible strategy that all members could support. Furthermore, the document was well received by the former colonial powers in Western Europe and North America to whom it was addressed. As one author had put it, Western Europe listened because Africa argued, not shouted. Domino theory. Another aspect of the overall AOU strategy was the application of what is known as the domino theory. In a few words, the theory focuses on the general morale of the population and postulates that if one state falls in a group of interrelated states like Southern Africa, the others will fall in quick succession like dominoes. Or to put it in another way, when one faces a powerful enemy, it's better to fight him at his weakest point first and then proceed in stages rather than invoke a total opposition at one time at the same time. In context, Southern Africa, the OAU strategy was to give maximum military and financial support to liberation movements of the Portuguese colonies so that they succeed first. Since liberation of those territories, the emphasis now has shifted to Zimbabwe and Namibia. Eventually, an independent Zimbabwe or Namibia could assist the OAU and confront the Republic of South Africa itself. But as we will discuss below, the strategy, in fact, was never to confront South Africa militarily. The domino theory has been criticized by the South African Liberation Movements, the PAC and the ANC. They argue that liberation forces and other Southern Africans could only succeed if the South African military forces were pinned down in South Africa itself. and therefore unable to render assistance to their neighbors. This point has been a subject of considerable debate and encounter between South African movements and the OAU Liberation Committee for almost a decade. Now I want to pause right there for a minute. That's the same thing, kind of like what Che Guevara said about how, you know, you got so many fires here and there that the United States have put out too many fires and stuff like that. And the same thing, kind of like Elder Cleavers was talking about, that, you know, you have a lot of fires, you know, with the black, you know, a lot of fires in the United States, and you got these fires going on elsewhere. It's kind of hard for them to put it out. You know what I'm saying? And it will keep forces pinned down where they need to be pinned down at. A strategy never tried, but you know what I'm saying, as we talked about with those two characters. But, you know, we'll see. Back to the story. In our view, the domino theory is applicable to the region of Southern Africa because of the sense of solidarity and a common destiny that has developed among the 50 million indigenous people of Southern Africa. The absence of major geographical barriers and the extensive movement of ordinary people across national boundaries in search of work and employment has built a sense of solidarity and common destiny among them. During the 10 years of Central African Federation, the stronger branches of the both the Mali Congress Party and the African National Congress of Zambia were in Rhodesia and South Africa. The liberation of Mozambique was warmly welcomed by Africans in Rhodesia and South Africa, where many Mozambicans were working. The economy of South Africa depends heavily on migrant labor from neighboring territories of Southern Africa. The Rhodesian government also relies heavily on Malawi and Mozambique labor. It is estimated that Southern Africa as a whole has about 2 million migrant laborers at any one time, i.e. persons working in other territories than their own. Our study elsewhere of the dynamics of the liberation wars has shown a critical role played by these migrant laborers. At close examination, the social structures of the Southern Africa shows two major contours and that are politically significant. The first refers to white society. There is a national bourgeoisie that runs the military-industrial complex and the mining industry of Southern Africa, one of the richest in the world, and is now increasingly intertwined with international capital. It's a stress that this national bourgeoisie, including the capital from a domestic base that are spread upward to link up with the financial, international finance capital and downward to link up with lucrative sources of colonial labor in the regions. This national bourgeoisie lost political power with the defender of General Smuts' United Party in South Africa in 1948. In the eclipse of Sir Roy Walensky, settler-dominated Central Africa Federation in Rhodesia in 1963. John Bush's National Party, which had been in power for the last 29 years, represent a coalition of plantation farmers and white trade unionists who insist on maintaining the racial and discriminatory practices and the sources of cheap African labor. Ann Smith, Rhodesia Front, represents a similar coalition of plantation farmers and trade unionists in Rhodesia. In particular, the plantation is an institution whose survival depends on the absolute maintenance of the colonial capitalist system with all its ramifications, especially control of labor and land by individual plantation owners. Half of the total land area of Rhodesia, 87% of the South African is plantation land, large and small. This class cannot afford a neocolonial situation implicit in the Lusaka Manifesto. On the African side, understandably, the most profound changes of the last 100 years have been the pluralization of the population and the declining of the peasantry. Through taxation and land shortages, the economic base of the peasantry has been destroyed, and they have been forced into the labor market as permanent or temporary wage earners. Consequently, a viable working class has developed in South Africa, Rhodesia, and Namibia, possibly more than any other country on the continent. It is this class, especially the migration section of it, that maintains a main component of liberation movement. The growing contact with the socialist countries in Eastern Europe and Asia that provide main training facilities and weapons for the movement has significantly radicalized the movement. The old nationalist leadership, drawn from a truncated petty bourgeoisie, has barely retaining any control of the dynamic movement. This movement has set its face against the colonial situation sought by both the Manifesto and the Kissinger's Memorandum. Sidebar, remember, Kissinger's Memorandum is Memorandum 39, Memorandum Tar Baby. Having outlined briefly the major clashes of contending power in Southern Africa, let us turn to the strategy of the Manifesto itself. Talking versus killing. The Lusaka Manifesto clearly state that we would prefer to negotiate rather than destroy, rather than to kill, but concludes that while peaceful progress is blocked by actions of those that at present in power and in states of Southern Africa, we have no choice but to give the people of those territories all support which we are capable in the struggle against their oppressors. This is why the sitting Northern states participating in the movement of liberation of Africa under the aegis of the OAU, peaceful negotiations and the armed struggles were therefore presented as two sides of the same coin. Negotiate peacefully whenever and whenever possible, and resort to fighting only when all else has failed, has remained a basic strategy of the senators of the OAU for the last 8 years. Let us examine the consequences of this strategy in the case of Zimbabwe. After the collapse of the Portuguese colonial empire in 1974, Lusaka resumed contact with Rwanda and stated that he feared there would be a war of consequences for those that were too ghastly to contemplate. He appeared to drop the threat of hitting Rwanda so hard that you will never forget it, containing exchanges in 1968. One point of the agreement in 1968 exchanges in the illegal situation of Ann Smith regime in Rhodesia was a threat to peace in the area. The point was not pursued. When Bush disclosed Parliament in 1970, that exchange had taken place, and Kwanda had published letters and any further contact had been discontinued. However, the powerful international financiers with business interests in both South Africa and Zimbabwe kept verbal contact at least between two men. In October 1974, at the University of Zambia graduation ceremony, attended by Sir Richard Lovett, Vice Chancellor of the University of Cape Town, and Sir Harry Oppenheimer, the financial magnate who heads one of South Africa's largest South African multinational corporation, the Anglo-American Corporation. Vandenberg praised Bolster publicly for the speech he made at Cape Town, calling for peace and painstakingly negotiations rather than war. Kanawana described the speech as the voice of reason that Africa has been waiting for. There is nothing outstandingly new or reasonable in the speech, but it besides the policy of Dante, which that was already underway. Again, the common ground has been struck between the two men over Rhodesia. Events followed whose general thrust was to stop the guerrilla war then raging on the northeastern Rhodesia and call for a constitutional conference with Chairman Smith regime on one side and African national leader, the ZAPU and the ZANU on the other. The Zimbabwe leaders were released from 11 years of detention and rushed from prison cells in Salisbury to the state house in Zambia. Edward Navalu, Deputy Secretary of the ZAPU, described the event as a surprise of the decade. In a circular to his members, he said, on the 8th of November, 1974, Chairman of the Revolutionary Council, Comrade J. Samoyo, and the Secretary of Publicity and Information, Comrade T.G. Sadinka, was called to the State House in Lagoska. There they met James Karima and George Nadaroro. The four were ushered into a prepared chamber by themselves. There they met the surprise of the decade, our president, Joshua Nkomo, and the Secretary of External Affairs, Comrade Joseph Miska, into the chamber. He, Nkomo, explained also that his coming to Lagoska was also to his pleasant surprise and had been arranged through diplomatic moves involving Dr. Karanda, Dr. Julius Nyerere, and Dr. Sid Karama of the regimes of South Africa and Rhodesia. Note below did not mention that this was Kumombo's second visit to La Casa in that month. He mentioned that the ZANU delegation, the Maravo shithole, had not come because his colleagues had been opposed to him in the Kwe Kwe prison. After a long and protracted power struggle, an internal ZANU confirmed this disposition by electing Secretary General Robert Mugabe as party leader. On November 7th, the issues of four national organizations, the ANC, ZANU, ZAPU, NFROLIZI, met again in La Casca to sign a unity accord covering complex and delicate issues on which there was no real meeting of the minds, although they may have been in agreement on paper. After considerable disagreement in the presence of the three presidents for 2 full days, on the third day, the delegation of the ZAPU, ZANU, FROLIZI, and the ANC met by themselves and took a fresh look at the question of unity which had been demanded by the frontline presidents. The following 7 points of the declaration was agreed upon and announced. 1. ZANU, ZAPU, FROLIZI, and the ANC hereby agree to unite in the ANC. The parties recognize the ANC as a unifying force of the people of Zimbabwe. 3. A, they agree to consolidate the leadership of the ANC by inclusion of it into the president of the ANC. 3B, ZANU and ZAPU and FROLIZI shall each appoint 3 other persons to join our large ANC executive. 4. The enlarged ANC executive shall have the following functions. A, to prepare for any conference for the transfer of power to the majority that might be called. B, to prepare for the holding of Congress within 4 months, at which I, a revised constitution shall be adopted. I2, the leadership of the United People of Zimbabwe shall be elected in. III, the statement of the policy for the new ANC should be considered. C, to organize the people in such a conference and Congress. 5, the leaders of the ZANU, ZAPU, and the FROLIZI call upon their supporters in all Zimbabweans to rally behind the ANC under the large executive. 6, the ANZU, the ZAPU, and the FROLIZI shall take steps to merge their respective organs and structures into the ANC before the Congress is to be held within 4 months. 7, the leaders recognize the inevitability of the continued armed struggle and all other forms of struggle until the total liberation of Zimbabwe. The declaration was signed December 8, 1974 by the 4 African leaders, Nomomo, ZAPU, Sitho, ZANU, Mozarana, ANC, and Shimika, FROLIZI. The thing that runs through this declaration was the unity of the people in Zimbabwe in light of projected constitutional conference. The frontline presidents had agreed with Borsa and Ann Smith on 5 points. That Smith will, 1, call a constitutional conference within 4 months. 2, release all political prisoners, including South Africans, in prison for their part in the Zimbabwe struggle. 3, lift a ban on political parties, ZANU and ZAPU, and allow free political activity. 4, suspend emergency laws, revoke death sentences, and repeal discriminatory laws. And 5, express willingness to shape the future of Rhodesia in an atmosphere of racial harmony, cooperation, and peace. In return for these concessions, Smith and Vosges only wanted one thing from the frontline presidents and seemingly United Zimbabwe movement: ceasefire in the Northeast District of Rhodesia. Smith never fulfilled any of the promises in full. He released the leaders and only 100 of 850 political prisoners. He finally did call a constitutional conference with Victoria Falls Bridge, which was planned to fail before it started, in spite of the personal presence of Bostongananda. And yet, for their part, the African states imposed a ceasefire by disrupting the only fighting movement at that time, ZANU. Seizing upon the unfortunate and untimely death of his patriotic chairman, Herbert Chibeto, and several measures taken by the Zambian government, Berkeley stopped the military operations in Northeast Rhodesia. Before the meeting at the bridge was supposed to be a constitutional conference, Smith told the press in Salisbury that it will only last 15 minutes. The verbatim record of what the meeting makes an interesting read. Apparently, Smith wanted the African delegation, led by Bishop Abel Morana, to put its signature to the minutes of prior to the meeting in Pretoria. The frontline states were represented by Pretoria meeting by Mark Turner, advisor to President Kwanda on foreign affairs, and possibly others. Smith insisted that the business of the bridge meeting was simply to initiate the Pretoria Agreement, although the agreement was not known to the Rwanda delegation. Smith refused the bridge to budge until Mark Rwanda himself interjected sharply to state that a person who was not at the meeting cannot be compelled to agree to what was discussed in their absence. Although the meeting did go on for 15 hours, no serious negotiations took place. Following the forgotten encounter at the bridge, flattering remarks by Smith, Joseph Kamama broke away from the ANC and established by the Accord and continued to hold meetings with Smith regime in Salisbury. Although Kamama met with one of the main conditions Smith had insisted upon at Pretoria and Victoria Falls meetings, namely that the talks were held inside Rhodesia, he did not get very too far. The Mumbo talks floundered on the same rock as previous talks, that Smith regime was adamant not to transfer power to the majority Africans. At the same time, Smith himself successfully warded off an attack from extremist settler elements and was within his own Rhodesian front, which accused him of trying to sell out white settlers to the corporate interests in Zambia. Their weekly newspaper warned, unless the electric wake up in time, it would soon find itself the victim of the blackest political deceit ever perpetrated in the country's history. The Prime Minister, Ann Smith, will be primarily responsible. After many months of secret moves with Winomo, it accused Harry Oppenheimer and his multinational corporation, the Anglo-American Corporation, trying to swerve the economy of Zimbabwe and South Africa at the expense of Rhodesia and Rhodesians, or the white ones. When the Winomo talk collapsed early in 1976, ZIPA guerrillas resumed operations through the independent Mozambique and the eastern and northeastern Rhodesia. The American Secretary of State, Henry Kissinger, entered the stage with a visit to the frontline states. His Lusaka speech in April 1976 and a subsequent meeting with Fischer in Germany opened his way for a settled diplomacy in September 1976. The settled prepared for the ground for a border of Geneva conference long before it adjourned on December 14th. It was obvious that there was no basis for an agreement. The Smith delegation took no serious part in the conference, insisting on total acceptance of what they called the Kissinger Package. This was negotiated in Pretoria in the absence of any representatives of Zimbabwe Africans. Reduced to one sentence, Smith wanted to maintain the status quo. His refusal to transfer power to the majority of Africans on the Tiger and the Phillips rejection of the Parson Commission and the Pierce Commission proposals. And he stand fast at Victoria Falls in Geneva and was hardened and deepened. Indeed, the Geneva Conference was bedeviled from the very beginning by its insistence on a power-sharing formula, supposed to be part of Kissinger Package, which would leave him in power during the interim period. If that happened, he would be seemingly fortunate in the position of being able to choose his own successor and a leader of supposedly impending Zimbabwe. The course of events and the continuing search for the Rhodesian settlement bring to light three major weaknesses of the Lusaka Manifesto Strategy. The first and the most serious is the continuing investigation over the heads of leaders of the Zimbabwe movement. No leader of the movement was consulted as the contents of the manifesto until it was published. This pattern has continued the implementation of it. Accepting Lumumba, no Zimbabwe leader was consulted seriously before Victoria Falls and Geneva conferences were set up. In fact, we can even state that the period between 1974 and 1976, the frontline states, in particular, and the OAU as a whole, had taken most of the initiative from the Zimbabwe leadership into their own hands. So they was ready to ball with the white folks to deal with them. So they just took them over and deal with us. Don't deal with the people in Zimbabwe, deal with us. We have already cited the 1974 agreement between the frontline states and Smith to cease fire in northeastern Rhodesia in return for 5 unfulfilled promises. No Zimbabwe leader entered that agreement with Smith. In particular, the ceasefire aspect had set back by several months of war that had been stuck deep in roots in a part of a country whose terrain was favorable to guerrilla war. To be fair to the frontline states on this point, they acceded to the formation of the Zimbabwe People's Army soon after the failure of the Bridge Conference, and against the advice and wishes of the leadership of the enlarged ANC, ZIPA initiated armed struggle, and ZANU reemerged. The one decision set back the revolution, while the other one saved it. But the practice of taking decisions over the heads of the established leadership of recognized movements remains a threat and a direct danger to the long-term interests of the movements in the struggle. The readiness to go to the conferences was with a proven liar like Ann Smith has brought much needed time and breathing space for its minorities and racist regime. The two phases of the OAU strategy, namely talking and killing, the Rhodesia evidence shows that the greater commitment is to talking. Indeed, it can be observed that some frontline leaders, the armed struggle is viewed as a pressure to bring Smith yet to another conference table. They are all too easily recalled experiencing their struggle for independence in the colonial setting. It did not go as far as the armed struggle. In this context, we should point out the great assistance that the FLELIMO and its experience have been in both the armed struggle and even at the Constitutional Conference discussed above. Perhaps the most important lesson to learn from the Lusaka Accord of 1974 refers to the preoccupation of the OAU with the question of unity. Admittedly, the unity of a struggling people gives them strength they need to fight a vicious enemy. But it's imperative that unity springs from the people and the movements of the country's concern. Enforced unity like the enlarged ANC failed to work because it did not have enough internal support among the groups and individuals within the movement itself. The suggestion of the Daily Mail of Zambia that President Kanaan should lock up Zimbabwe leaders in a room in the state house and leader Darren Tatu agree to unite should be treated with scorn because it was fraught with danger for the movement's concern. Unity is like a fresh flower which is given time and space and material support so that it grows and blossoms. Furthermore, unity should be based on clearly stated objectives. Now read it again. Unity should be based on clearly stated objectives and perceived advantages in the military field. If unity is to last, it must be personal. So, in the case of liberation movements fighting anti-imperialist and anti-colonial war, the only firm basis of unity is a socialist ideology aiming at overthrowing the capitalist system. More importantly, this should be an agreement to overthrow the system by armed force. All right. More importantly, there should be an agreement to overthrow the system by armed force. An agreement on two basic principles is necessary in order to attain a viable united front. To be meaningful, unity has to be planted in that of the anti-imperialist and anti-capitalist ideology soil in order to grow and blossom. In this context, the Patriotic Front of ZANU and ZAPU has a greater chance of success than the ANC of 1974 had. The front have relied heavily on progressive elements that developed in both organizations in the course of fighting, recruiting, and organizing. The original FROLIZI, headed by Shelton Sawilla, has similar objectives of uniting with ZAPU and ZANU fighting, but failed abysmally because of fairly conservative elements that were entrenched in key positions, and finally took over leadership under James Carrabo. James Chickasamara, we call him that. So when the guy, the original Ferrari, the FROLIZI, headed by Shelton Sawilla, a guy we never heard of, you know what I'm saying? He had similar objectives of uniting with the Zappa, the Zappu, and the ZANU fighting the spiders, but it failed abysmally because conservative elements that were entrenched in key positions. Now, as long as you got conservative elements, or as we talked about before, a indigenous bourgeoisie class in there, you're not going to win. You're just going to become like the NAACP or, you know, the Urban League, shit like that. You're not going to win because they don't have fresh ideas. And they're just doing what, you know, what is already known from the book. You understand what I'm saying? And then eventually from that, they just hijack the movement. Like, they just hijack this one, you know, and force it down your throat. These people was in the guerrilla warfare with the white regime of Rhodesia. And these four frontline presidents came in and hijacked it to get them in the OAU, to get them to follow, well, we can still talk to these people. And, you know, that's in 1974, and this is 2020. So they've been talking for a long, long time. You know what I'm saying? But that's the key they wanted, a long, slow talk, you know, like a civil rights movement type thing. Just with more guns, and they out of bounds, as they always are. Anyway, and subscribe to the channel. We drop stuff like this all the time. Much love to my ancestors. We're going to read more about this and get more into Operation Memorandum Tire 39, the Tire Baby Memorandum. So, you know, much love. Enjoy the channel. Peace. Hotep. You know what I'm saying? And stay safe, man. Peace.